Most big pubs in big cities don't want the over 50s nursing a pint for an hour. It's not going to happen. Also, some families, right, some partners may have younger partners. Like for me, it would be, I'm going at the pub now, you're coming. What do you mean you can't come? Oh, you don't get vaccinated till September. I'll see you later.
So I try, well, not necessarily weird, but sometimes different. So one of the things I did, and I decided I was going to shave all the hair off my body. Everything. Clean as the board of hell. Come on, get on out of here, man. I was talking to my son. He's walking through.
Shit, because I'm thorough with my research. That's half a ton of little shits per dog. You know? And I say little shits, but obviously, the bigger the dog, the bigger the fucking log. You know? I seen it the other day. This guy was walking his mobile turd production plant. And this thing squeezed out what I can only describe as a subway poo. Foot long.
We don't want to say BAME anymore because it's not right.
I like it. It encompasses everyone, doesn't it? And I think, they say it's lazy, don't they? But it's like, shall we say, you know, so if someone's white British, they might say, no, I'm white Irish or white Scottish, right? And then if we start calling them, like put them under all in one under umbrella, right? And just call them whiteys.
Whiteys?
No, does that work?
And then right at the end of the year, I contracted something that's now living inside one of my internal organs, using my blood, making me feel quite ill. Growing bigger and bigger. Yeah, I'm pregnant.
Hello, my goodness gracious me. It's week eight back in the hen house. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. We have a great lineup of comedians here with you this evening. I don't know what to say. It's still Easter. I love Easter. I know. I'm not religious, thank God. But no. I like the fact that we've had 2 weeks off because like I've just enjoyed the time on my own, just sitting down, binging out on box sets. It's been great. God knows what I'm going to do when I have to go back to work in 2022. But it's really nice to be here. Please, if you're watching this stream now live, because I know a lot of you do, this is the time where you share the stream with all your friends. In fact, it's probably better to share it with everyone you don't like, to be fair. I'm not saying, share it. That's all I'm saying. Share the stream. Comment, please. We like your comments. We've got a friend watching. Hello! Biff Buffety Beavity Wizard and Will. Will's here. Say hi, Will. So please do share the stream. Do say hello. Do leave your comments. The comedians tonight, they need your feedback. They do. Well, they don't need your feedback. When feedback is good. Good feedback is what they need. That's what they want. They want little clapping hand emojis, thumbs up, even a little comment saying, I laughed at that. It's all good stuff. Now, because it's Easter, I was going to do this last week, but, one thing led to another. And so I forgot. And as nothing really important happened today. In fact, it's not important. I don't even know why I said that. Woo! It's just on the 90. It's the 99th day of the year today. Did you know that? The 99th day of the year today. I'm here to give you facts, interesting facts. That's probably what it is. I will provide as much feedback as I can feasibly manage. There you go. God bless you. So, I don't know where you all went, really. You were doing all so well. In fact, could you just ring up your friends and tell them to start watching? You can watch this on YouTube. You can watch it on Facebook. You can watch it on Twitch. Right. This is what I was going to do last week. Jesus is on the cross, on a hill outside Golgotha. He is tired, exhausted and bloodied. He looks far away into the distance and cries out, Peter. Peter is in the city, yet he hears his master's voice upon the wind. He drops to his knees and says, Master, I am here. Jesus again cries out, Peter. Peter jumps to his feet and runs down the street of Golgotha as fast as he humanly can, knocking over two Roman guards on his way. They seize him and beat him to within an inch of his life. Lying in a pool of his own blood, he hears the voice of Jesus fainter than before. Peter. He drags himself to his feet and looks up upon the hill. And Christ's crucified body is silhouetted by the moon. Peter. Peter. Peter, still in agony, drags himself to the gates of the city. The gate is guarded by 20 Roman guards. And as he staggers through, each guard knocks and spits and punches him. The disciple carries on, ignoring his pain and the callous laughter from the guards. He reaches to the foot of the hill. Pain shoots through him as he falls to the ground. One of the guards has broken two of his ribs. Peter! The voice is louder and clearer than before. Ignoring the pain that begins to crawl slowly, he begins to crawl slowly and slowly up the hill. Master, I am coming. Two-thirds of the way up the hill, Peter spots a group of Roman guards making their way back down the hill. The leader of the guards, a big blonde oaf, swings a kick high at Peter's chest and sends the acolyte tumbling back down towards the ground. Peter blacks out for 10, 15 minutes. When he comes to, again he hears the voice of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour. Peter! Determined to make it to his Lord, Peter scrambles up the hill, managing to avoid all other obstacles in his way. Finally, he prostrates himself at the foot of Jesus' cross. He is bruised and covered in blood. With a trembling voice, he says, Master, I am here. The voice from the cross is weak. Peter. With a final effort, Christ's favourite disciple crawls his way to the top of the cross, placing his ear as close as he can towards his master's mouth. Jesus smiles and says, Peter, I can see your house from here.
We would be damaging the fabric of the Union with regulatory checks and even customs controls between Great Britain and Northern Ireland on top of those extra regulatory checks down the Irish Sea that are already envisaged in the withdrawal agreement. Now, I have to tell you, no British Conservative government could or should sign up to any such arrangement. No British Conservative government, no British Conservative government could or should sign up to any such arrangement.
Caught me out there. I was just about to read something, but I wasn't. Right, yeah, no, seriously? Who'd have thought 4 years ago? Who'd have thought 4 years ago we'd be back in this fucking mess? Who are you? I'll tell you who. The experts again. Whoa, pesky experts. Why are we listening to them? Right. That's it, really. That's it. I don't know what I'm doing now. I'm a little bit confused. But as I say, we have a great lineup tonight. Not only are we going to America, not only are we going to Wolverhampton, not only are we going to London or Germany, we're going to Scotland. Oh, yes! Or should I say, och, aye! Hi!
Hey, Steve, how you doing?
You're right. I should have introduced you. It's Jimmy. Is that right? That's right. Oh, yeah. Jimmy, Jimmy yeah, Longmuir. Yeah, yeah. There you go. How you going? All right?
Yeah, I'm all right, man. All right.
That's it. That's me. All right, fine.
That's all the chat I've got. Sorry, man.
That's all the chat we need. So what part of Scotland are you from? Arbroath?
Glasgow.
Ah, I know Glasgow.
Yeah.
It's in Scotland. That's all I know. I know Edinburgh's in Scotland.
It's pretty much right in the middle of Scotland. Scotland's best city, didn't you know?
Is it? I know somebody from Edinburgh and they say Edinburgh is Scotland's best city.
They would say that, but they would be wrong.
Okay. that's fine. Okay, shall I ask you a political question?
Nah.
It's a choice. It's like a yes or no or good or bad thing. Sturgeon or salmon?
Neither. I mean, like any politician, they can all go take a fuck to themselves, as we say here in Glasgow.
take a fuck to themselves.
Yeah.
I think that's fine. That's fine. here we go. Glasgow once voted as happiest city and found to be the murder capital of the UK in the same time. Is that right?
That's because all the people that were murdered were terrible people, so we became happy as a result of it.
Hey, that's a good analogy. I like that. I went to see Public Image Limited in Leamington Spa, and Johnny Rotten said that Leamington Spa had the most murders per capita in the country.
Right.
So maybe Glasgow should be twinned with Leamington Spa.
Yeah, I don't think it will be, though.
No, I don't. Right. Hey,
do you
think we've had
enough
chat?
Not going to happen, man.
Oh, I know I was going to ask you something. Because you do a podcast, do you not?
I do, yes, I do. It's called All Lockdown, How We Laughed.
Say that again in English.
All Lockdown, How We Laughed.
Oh, Lockdown, okay, sorry.
Yeah, and I've been interviewing comedians around the world and things, but I kind of get bored of just interviewing comedians and talking about Zoom comedy and things, so I've been basically interviewing anybody who's creative, who's kept going under lockdown. All different
industries. Hey, cool.
I interviewed an artist earlier on today, and I've interviewed comic artists. I've got this guy called Frank McNabb, who's from Glasgow. His name might have been a clue there. And I've been interviewing loads of people, really enjoying it, and hopefully you'll come on the show at some point as well and talk about Hen House.
I could do with, you know, because like I could talk for England and that would be nice. I've got a very, very varied life story.
Cool.
I'm not going to tell you that. I'll tell you what. Ask me a question, right? Put this in your head about the misplaced baby when my mother gave birth.
What about that misplaced baby when your mother
not now,
gave birth?
Not now. You can have that as an exclusive. I don't really want to talk about it.
Okay.
All right. Hey, are you ready to go?
Yeah, I'm fine, man. Yeah.
I'm sure she still is my mother. Right, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome, first time in the Hen House, it's Jimmy Longmuir.
Thanks very much, Steve. Well, I've actually been walking about with my set written in my fucking hand all day, so if you happen to see me in the supermarket, I'm sorry for the spoilers, but you know, if you could read the jokes, you were standing too close.
Obviously, I'm here to tell some jokes, but given the format, I feel like I should be issuing some kind of plea or assurance to the camera, like, I'm okay, no one's hurt me, they're feeding me, but can you please, please make sure the funds are transferred by close of business on Friday? It's probably just this lockdown messing with my head. It was okay at the start this time last year. Well, when lockdown started last March, I was going around my neighbourhood on long walks and things. But one day I went pretty far and found myself somewhere that was technically very crowded. Although everybody stayed at least 6 feet away, so that was good. But all the same, I never went back to that graveyard. And I managed to keep myself safe, well and busy back at the start of lockdown. Mainly I kept myself busy by assuring everyone I know in different apps that I was safe and well. By 3 months in, whenever anyone texted me to ask how I was doing, I felt like texting back, I'm doing the same as you, I'm pretending everything's fine, now fuck off. I actually served a short 6 week prison sentence 20 years ago, and I've never been able to describe prison accurately until now. Now I can tell anyone who asks, prison was almost exactly like this lockdown, except I didn't have to put up with your partner and kids, and I knew when it was going to be over. And I get sick of wanking in lockdown. How do you even get sick of wanking? I didn't even know it was possible. And I blame 5G for that. I think conspiracy theorists are right about 5G. And I thought 5G was going to be a good thing for shit and porn addicts. I mean, even monkeys in captivity get to enjoy a little wank from time to time. I know that for a fact because that was an awkward family outing. Although if you're a zookeeper, what could you do about a monkey that keeps wanking anyway? I'm sure it's much harder to explain to an 8-year-old why your monkeys don't have any hands. I've done a few jokes about the lockdown, but I'm not going to make any jokes about the coronavirus itself because I'm old enough to remember jokes about the planes in 9/11 and they never landed. And I had to come off Tinder at the start of lockdown, which was just as well for me because I was overusing Tinder. Every time I went on Tinder, I was using photos of myself on stage and girls were always saying, you're just looking for material, aren't you? And I was like, yeah, have you got any going out on all these crazy dates? And I think the reason I was overusing Tinder was because in a pretty bad relationship before that. In fact, my last relationship was so toxic, you could have used its energy to get a DeLorean back to 1985. It was okay at first. It actually turned out she was into BDSM at the start, which is something I'm not too familiar with. My personal philosophy with BDSM is it's okay to order things off the internet and, you know, maybe read 50 Shades of Grey. But if you find yourself in a city centre dungeon, obliged to address some off-duty security guard as sir, probably took it too far. But I found out she was into BDSM on her second date when she appeared on my doorstep wearing a French maid's outfit and she asked me to tie her to a black swivel chair I've got in the middle of my living room. So, you know, I complied with her wishes and tied her to this black swivel chair and she said, you can do anything you want to me. And I was like, kind of getting that from the fact you're tied to a black swivel chair in the middle of my living room. I didn't think we were rehearsing for a kinky mastermind. Although by that point, if she'd asked me to stop, I genuinely don't know if I'd just said I've started, so I'll finish. It turned out she was into dogging as well, and I'd get really excited about that, until I realised that neither of us had a car. But she was into other things as well. She was into like arts and crafts and dance and all these types of fiction and dress-up that I'd never heard of, like steampunk. I don't know if you know what steampunk is, but it's basically Victorian-era cyber fiction, which is where I think she picked up such effective gaslighting skills. But I mean, like I say, it was a toxic relationship, and I played my part in how messed up it got as well. Like, the last night we were in bed together, she told me that I was selfish. She said I was ignorant. And, you know, she said something else, but I can't remember what it was because I was having a wank at the time. But anyway, we split up a long time ago and ended up overusing Tinder and I had to come off Tinder at the start of lockdown. But, you know, with restrictions easing and things like that and allowed to meet outside, I figured I'd just go for a little Tinder date tonight and I actually matched with a girl. And we went out for a coffee in the park. And we're getting on really, really well. And I liked her and she seemed to like me. And at one point, I leaned over to take her hand, and she just looked at my hand and started walking away. And I was like, wait, wait, where are you going? Because I thought I'd breached social distancing. And when she turned around, she said, why the fuck do you have BDSM, dogging, toxic relationship, gaslighting, and wanking monkeys written in your fucking hand? But, cheers, thanks very much, that's me.
I'm trying to press the button, but it's not working. Sorry about that.
I was like, no, am I going to have to keep talking?
Yeah, no, I was, oh, man, thank you so much. I was wanking. I'm going to be honest with you. That is the worst thing about lockdown. It did so... Hey, there's a that's a good gaslighting joke. I don't know. Is this meant to be? I don't know who that is. Oh, that's laughing faces.
Right.
I don't know who it was. Oh, thanks. So, hey, you going to stay around for the caption competition?
Sure. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Have you seen the pictures?
Were they in the email?
Oh, look, I'll tell you what.
Yes, I have seen them. I read the email, all of it. Yes, I have.
I read the email, all of them. Just in case people are not... you can go to the Hen Nights page as well. And there we have our captions competition. So look at the pictures. You can leave your comments there. We've already had quite a few people commenting, which is lovely. So that's our first picture. You don't have to stay it yet. Just there's our second picture. That looks to me. No, I'm not going to say it yet. And then that's our third picture. So there you go. That's what people will be commenting on later. I've got to do stop sharing screens as well. There you go. Oh, look at that. We're widescreen. Thank you so much, Jimmy. I will see you in a minute.
My pleasure. Okay.
Jimmy, I've written it down. Longmuir, thank you very much. Bye-bye. Wow, what a night of fun and frolics we are having here in the Hen House. I've even been invited onto a podcast to talk about me. That's going to be a long one. Right, who's next up in the H-E-N House? I like that. I've got too many touchscreens and not enough mice. There we are. We're going to... Hello, America! If you're a big fan of Def Leppard, and if you're not... Hey, what?
No.
Oh, no, not at all.
No, I swear I went to see them one time and they got sprinkled on and they left stage after three songs.
Wow. When was that then? Because you're quite young, no offense.
Oh, no. I'm 35.
Yeah, that's what I said, quite
so
young.
So it's old enough to hate Def Leppard, basically. Yeah. Not old enough to be into them, but...
I tell you, when I first saw Def Leppard, the drummer was 13 years of age and his mother had to sit on the stage with him because it was in a drinking place. So 13-year-olds weren't allowed in unless they had their mother or father with them.
Yeah, and he couldn't drum and drink at the same time anyway, right? Because it says one hand, right?
Well, no, he had two then. It was before the accident.
Okay.
he was only 13. But that's how old I am.
Must have been something back then.
That's it. So, Joe Christensen.
Yeah.
I've got your name written over there just in case I got it wrong. But no, I didn't introduce you. I just said, let's go and say hello, America. Whereabouts in America are you?
I'm in the Twin Cities. Does that mean anything outside
yes,
of the Twin
does.
Cities?
The Twin Cities is the Twin Cities of Bogota.
Yeah.
No, you actually,
Bogota in North Bogota.
There you go.
Yeah, it's Minneapolis, Minnesota, and St. Paul, Minnesota are the Twin Cities.
Oh, because Minneapolis and Minnesota are two cities, but they are twinned.
Right next to each other.
Oh, right next to each other.
St. Paul, yeah.
Oh, that's like huge. England and Europe.
Yeah.
Right, I tell you what, I'm going to rush through tonight because I talk too much. So,
right.
Are you ready to get going?
Yeah, let's do it.
Excellent. Ladies and gentlemen, first time in the house, the Hen House, is Joe Christensen from this Twitter. Oh, man.
Bye.
Bye. Sorry.
Hey, thanks, Steve. So I'm 35 years old, and a lot has changed in these past 35 years. Like, I remember when I was a little kid, I thought it'd be totally rad to live in my parents' basement. But now that I'm 35 years old, I don't think it's totally rad to live at all. I'm learning a lot at my kettlebells class. Like, you guys know they're really heavy and I can't get my money back? I just read the book series Goosebumps for the first time. You guys heard of Goosebumps? That was some scary shit. That Goosebumps book was so scary, terror diarrhea. I remember one time I brought a lady back from the bars, and she said she wouldn't have sex with me until I could remember her name. I'm like, what are you, fucking Rumpelstiltskin or something? And she said no, which made me really sad because that was like my 50th guess. I wanted to be an illusionist when I was growing up. I was a big fan of David Copperfield. Yeah, big fan of David Copperfield. I tried really hard at it. Problem was, my family was very ambivalent about my passions. Like, half my family thought I would never be good at magic, and the other half were severed legs. I just went on a date with a sapiosexual. I don't know if you know what a sapiosexual is. But a sapiosexual, if you want to know, is someone who comes every time they have to explain what the word sapiosexual means. Did you guys know that the reason that Bono of U2 wears those sunglasses is because of a medical condition? Yeah, his doctor told him he has to look really fucking cool. Comedy's a scam. Don't get into it. It's not the way to make it in Hollywood. What I'm going to do is I have a three-step plan for making it huge. Step number one is pretty easy. I just have to convince my girlfriend to have three babies. No big deal, right? Number two, I have to teach those three babies how to juggle. And then number three, easiest part, I just have to learn how to juggle three babies. Sweet kid. I drink way too much coffee. I drink like three pots of coffee a day. It's a huge problem. It's become such a big problem. I've had to start going to Coffee Addicts Anonymous, which sounds super lame, Coffee Addicts Anonymous, but check this shit out. Free beer. They say it takes a village to raise a child, and that's especially true with Billy the 100-foot-tall boy. Okay. Man, I wish it was like my uncle. My uncle can make anyone laugh. Make anyone laugh, because he has a gun. Yeah, he's the kind of guy that likes to call liquor aiming fluid. He also calls manslaughter oopsie daisies. Pretty fucking fun dude. What, you're saying it's not okay in 2021 to hold a door open for a woman? Just because it's a revolving door? Whatever, dude, stuck in door. Seem kind of biased on this. I used to think the loneliest image imaginable was a grown man sitting alone on a teeter-totter. Yeah, but then I bought that sex swing. Now it's just a regular swing in my basement. You should come check that shit out. It's a blast. Did you know that the swastika was actually an ancient Hindu symbol? Yeah, it meant racist windmill. That's why the Nazis were so into it. They loved wind power and white power, right? Okay. My favorite inventor of all time has to be Benjamin Franklin. I don't know if you know the story of Benjamin Franklin, but one night he tied a key to a kite, and that led to the invention of, yes, led to the invention of the flying key, the same flying key we all use and love today. I'm starting to think that sumo wrestling is rigged. Yeah, they're always letting some fat fuck win. What's up with that? I hate idioms. Idioms are dumb. Like that one idiom. Don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. I don't get it. I can't relate to that. For one, I don't own a baby. You know, at least not since that bathwater thing that happened. They say one of the best ways to avoid being hit on at the bar is to wear a wedding ring. And that's kind of true, but I think even an even better way that works for me is to wear one of those big Thanos gloves that you can get at a toy shop. I think it's a pretty good way of doing it. I think probably the worst thing, I'll just leave you with this. I think probably the worst thing about getting your penis stuck in one of those Chinese finger traps is knowing that you have a real small penis. But probably the best thing about getting your penis stuck in one of those is knowing that the other guy understands. All right, thanks.
I do. I do understand.
You do understand.
I get it. I get it.
I don't know language barrier stuff, whether or not any of you can understand anything I'm saying. So
there was the one thing I was thinking was the thing you said before, the sex swing, because I know what a sex swing is, but
a revolving door?
No, I know what a revolving
those
door
are called,
is.
Like spinning magoos over there or something?
Revolving okay. door. They're just called.
Okay, I don't know.
No, toppy turvy? Like is that like a swing and a child's toy swing? Seesaw?
Oh, yeah, I know a seesaw. Yeah.
No, but before you said it's a sex swing. Before that, you were talking about a toppy turvy or something.
I don't know.
There you go.
I'll add it to my set list, though.
That's it. I'm sure it was a child's play area slide or a swing or a seesaw. I am digging too deep. I can't get out of this.
I think you probably have, just looking at your backdrop, I bet you have a tappy turvy.
What's a tappy turvy? Is that?
I don't know what it is. You're the one with the light bulb on your hat.
I've got loads of things. Hey, are you going to stay around for the caption competition?
When is that?
It's after B. B's next. Oh no, it's Ab. It's about 10 minutes.
Okay, yeah, I'll stick around. I might be excelling spreadsheeting in the background.
Oh, because you're working, aren't you?
Yeah.
You
know,
I forgot because you're in the two cities of Missinopa City that you've got work to do. If you can, great. If not, we understand. All right, because work's more important than doing something for a Brit in the evening. All right. Hey, thanks so much, Joe. What's his face?
Thanks, Steve.
No, look, honestly, I've got it written down. It's Joe Christensen, everyone.
Thank you
very much. Cheers, mate. Bye-bye. Wow. I cut them off in their prime, which is great. Biff Buffy Wizard is saying, do the sex swing joke. Whoa. Hey, good. Come on, people. I need more comments. I need you to share. If I could turn back time. I know. You should see my falsetto. Right. Going over now to see Av Singh with some breaking news. Av!
Breaking news, Steve. Thundercats are... Oh!
No idea what that means. Av Singh, thank you. Can you hear that? I don't even know. I don't know if anything's working in the world. Do you know what I mean? Hallelujah. Av's obviously stuck. Av, you there, mate? Hey, there he is. Hey, Av. Hey, a lot of people were saying that last week's news segment was videoed.
Oh. No, it's always live. I think I can give you some breaking news regarding Prince Philip.
Oh, do you have to?
He's left the hospital.
Oh, cool. That's good because we were quite concerned about him, really.
Yeah, I know.
So he left the hospital what? Yesterday, was it, or the day before? What day is it? It's Wednesday. Yeah, that's cool. Yeah. Well, hope he's all right. Well, so what else is happening in the news this week?
Very sad to announce, actually. Let's get serious now. The passing away of, I don't know how to say it, someone everyone thought very highly of. And what I want to do is, I'm going to quote some of his famous advice to certain people he's given throughout his time as a Duke of Edinburgh. If that's okay, Steve.
Yeah, I'll let you do that on your own, shall I?
Yeah. Can you just turn the music up? I think it'd be quite apt.
don't know if it, I'm not even sure if it's coming through or it's just going through my mic.
I can hear it. So, whilst pointing at old fashioned fuse box in a factory near Edinburgh, he said, "It looks as if it was put in by an Indian." Whilst in China in 1986 on a state visit, he spoke to a British student and he said to him, "This is difficult. If you stay here much longer, you'll be slitty-eyed." In Australia in 2002, whilst talking to a successful Aborigine entrepreneur, he said, "Do you still throw spears at each other?" To a 24-year-old Barnstable Sea cadet named Elizabeth Randall, when she told him she had to work in a nightclub, he asked, "Do you work in a strip club as well?" To a 25-year-old counter worker called Hannah Jackson, who was wearing a dress with a zip on the front, he said, "These are forgettable words. I would get arrested if I unzipped that dress." In Scotland, he upset a few people when he was talking to a driving instructor. Back in 1995, he said, "How do you keep the natives off the booze long enough to pass the test?" "Sorry, Steve, I can't go on anymore. Can you come back, please? I'm finding it very difficult, emotional."
I get that. Because he's, you know, he's not all good. So,
what do you mean? I just said his best bit.
Hey, no, look. The thing is, it leaves more room now for Prince Andrew, so that's always a good thing. So, Av, we're going to do the caption competition in a minute. Is that all right? You'll be back for that?
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, cool. Excellent. That's excellent.
If you,
right.
That's if you have me back after that.
No, I think it came from the heart, and that's excellent. So... because we've got two more acts to get through, right? And one of them's having dinner with his wife, and I don't want to spill all that. So, we'll see you in a minute, Av. All right. Thank you. That's Av Singh, ladies and gentlemen. A lovely tribute there to a man who was 99. Right. We're going over to Germany to see a friend. I like it when we have a friend at the hen house. We're going to see BC Tree. Hello.
Hey. Hi. Good to see you, Ian.
How are you?
I'm doing good. Yeah, happy to be here again.
My mother taught me to be a gentleman, right? Which is probably weird, but like, have you had your hair done? It looks nice.
I know, it's sort of strange. Yes, I have had my hair.
Is it a different color as well?
No, think it's always been this color, but it was growing in. But I don't know. Did we see each other last year? Maybe that's it.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, yeah. It was shorter and yeah.
No, I like it. I like it. It's you're rocking it. So there you go. it's important, I think. I don't know if my music is still going on.
I think that's why they opened the beauty shops first. They're like, okay, let's get these people clean.
Oh, sorry.
Okay.
My keyboard. I put my finger down on my keyboard. That's a weird thing. I've never done that before. I've got a touch screen up here and a keyboard down there. But you're right. I understand. Look at my hair. It's not. So I cut it myself. So yeah, no. I think we can get our hair cut on from Monday.
Oh, okay. Monday they let you go into the hairdresser.
Yeah, because are you in Germany?
Is that yeah, right? I'm still in Germany. In a while
Hamburg. If I yeah. So how long have you been able to have your hair cut? That's honestly exciting.
Actually I do cut my hair myself. I have it colored. It was I have it colored white because I wasn't growing old fast enough, so I decided to color it white.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah, okay.
Because look at this compared to that, I tell you.
Yeah, it does look different. The curtains don't match the rug.
I have no idea what that means.
Yeah.
All right, are you ready to go?
Yeah.
Excellent. Ladies and gentlemen, back in the hen house, it's BC Tree.
Hey, everybody. Yeah, so what I find stupid right now is daylight savings time. I'm in Germany, and on Sunday, we moved the clocks ahead an hour for more sunlight. This is crazy. People are saying things like our circadian rhythms. What? We're not freaking crickets. I think we can handle sunlight and darkness. I mean, after 200 freaking years, we should be able to handle sunlight and darkness. Anyhow, how much time have we gathered? I'm 50, and so I calculated that I have 2 days. It's not like we're going to get overtime on life. You know, it's lousy time travelers. Like, we could go an hour in the future and not change anything. You know, I haven't even gotten a tan from this extra hour of sunlight. Yeah, so it's a stupid thing to do that we do every year. So I'm from a small town in Germany called a while back. I moved to a while back, but I still live here. So I've lived here a while. It's small. You want to know how small it is? It's so small that we keep our hands in our pockets so there's enough room. It's so small, we speak in contractions so we'll not lose more oxygen. It's so small that if more than three women are on their periods, we get an automatic flash flood warning. A while back sits next to a forest, and this is where witches leave their brooms at night. Do you guys know Grimm's fairy tales, these fairy tales, Cinderella? Well, these witches are real, and they do knitting in the city. And they're knitting from worry. They are great at nonverbal communications of concern about me doing something I shouldn't be doing. So they are very concerned. And yet I stepped into it, a fairy tale. Only for a glass slipper, I got weaved Birkenstocks. Yeah. Yeah, and all of these worried, knitted brows have gotten us into the Guinness Book of World Records. That's right, for the most knitted brows, all of this concern, which we realized we could actually make lucrative because we could knit these brows and have them double as bras to lift the bags under your eyes. So now we sell these little bras. Yes, that's right. It's crazy. And I'm documenting it all right now. It's crazy. And I'm right now starring in my own documental. That's right, me. I can't believe it. I'm in nature here. Me, I'm a concrete kid from Indiana. There's so much concrete in Indiana, the sky is permanently gray. I took my kids to the mall, and when I came back, there was I had to pick them up, and it was the penitentiary. I had locked them in the prison. They looked the same. Mall, prison, they looked the same. Yep. And growing up, I had heard of sticks and stones can break your bones, but that was only a theory. You know, I had heard of it, but I didn't do anything. I tried to avoid sticks and stones as best as I could till Land's End. And rock climbing, yeah, well, not really. I mean, the rocks are in my drink and it's my tongue actually going over the ice cubes in my cup. So yeah, the police love to do drive-bys, and my best talent is being wasted. So this is the news from a small town in Germany called a while back. And I am BC Tree, and you are excellent. Ooh, do I have more time? Should I keep going? Where are you, Henn?
yeah, I was trying to do two things at once, and that's not going to happen. Oh, there it is. There you are. We're going on to the caption competition, but it looks like it's not happy with me. I don't know why, but we'll bring the others in and then see what happens. Oh, we'll say hello to Haroon first. Haroon!
Hello, how are you?
How are you? You're coming up to close the show, aren't you?
Oh, I am indeed, yes. Happy to be here as well.
That's excellent. So are you all right to do the you've got no choice, you're here. Caption competition. We're going to get Joe. Joe's not at work. We get Jimmy and Av. Wow. Look at that. So let's start off with this one. Has anyone got anything for this? I might actually, look, I'm getting Doctor Who clips as well coming in. There you go. Anyone got anything for that?
Piers Morgan asks about new presenter. How dark is he?
Piers Morgan in disguise to get back into Good Morning, but the dress is too tight. Anybody else? No. All right, that's a difficult one. I'll give you that one. Oh, there's one.
That's what really happened to Prince Philip.
hey man, I was stoned.
Prince Philip goes for one last drive.
Oh man, I had a cop with like a silly hat. Is that what's funny about this? The silly hat?
That's not a silly hat. That's a respectable piece of uniform.
And our culture, they're highly regarded. You seem to have offended every British person.
That's right. You never say to them, does the head go all the way up to the top? You never say that.
We don't come over to America and slag off your police hats, man. That's terrible.
Oh, I don't give a shit. You can punch our cops in the face. I don't care.
Well, that's an American loses control of car after seeing man in funny hat.
So we're not going to beat that one. So here we go.
It's Prince Philip again. Surprise, I'm alive.
Yeah. Is it Gavin Williamson mishears invite to House of Commons bondage session? Yeah. On the chief whip?
But hey, Mom, I got my tongue pierced.
Piers Morgan rings the Samaritan after total personality transplant.
It's actually Prince Philip, and he's phoning the Queen to say the step one of the mummification processes went well.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah. Is it the driver of the white car who crashes into house?
Prince Philip requests private and slightly creepy funeral.
Good. Okay, that's it. We're going to go with that. Thank you so much. Let's remove that. Look at you all there. Brilliant. Thank you so much. Now you can all stay and watch Haroon do his stuff. Are you ready? Haroon,
I'm ready to do my stuff, yeah, and I'm also ready to watch myself do my stuff.
Okay, well, that's cool. Right, so I don't know if this works, but if I just bring you in, Haroon, we'll see if they can laugh with you, but I'm not sure if they will. But it, well, no,
it
I'm not saying
first
no.
In my comedy career.
Yeah, no, I didn't mean it like that. I don't think the technology allows them for you to hear them. That's what I'm saying.
That's right.
So, ladies and gentlemen, another friend of the Henn House. It's Haroon Mashod. Ah.
Hello, yes, my name is Haroon Mashod. Before I do anything, I'd just like to join you sharing my condolences with you about Prince Philip. As you can see, I am appropriately dressed. And in his memory, I will also be doing 5 minutes on Peter's. Now, one of my hobbies, particularly during the pandemic, is reading. And last week, I decided I'd try a bit of comic fiction. So I picked up the government's commission report on race and ethnic disparities. I'm only on chapter one, but so far, one of the funniest things I have read for a long time. So the authors, to be honest, couldn't have been better picked to ensure that I had enough material for at least one full Edinburgh show. First of all, they were all chosen by Boris Johnson's head of policy, Munira Mirza, who had previously claimed institutional racism was no longer relevant. Three of the commission, including its chair, Tony Searle, are on record as having said that institutional racism or white privilege is no longer a thing. Another works for Ian Duncan Smith's right-wing think tank and writes a column for the Daily Mail. A fifth runs a chain of school academies that specialises in harsh discipline. A sixth is an economist who believes foreign aid is a waste of money. And the seventh is a businessman who campaigned for breakfast. So that's seven out of a total of nine commissioners who either don't believe in institutional racism or white privilege, or who are identifiably extreme right-wing Tories, all answering to another Tory who doesn't believe institutional racism is a thing. And you know what? The commission concluded that institutional racism isn't a thing. I, for one, surprised. Now, the report's core conclusion is that, quote, we no longer see a Britain where the system is deliberately rigged against ethnic minorities. And as we all know, if it isn't deliberate racism, then it's not a problem. Luckily, there's no such thing as indirect racism or unconscious bias or white privilege, or there really would be a problem. Now, a lot of the report is about education. And the Commission recommends the creation of a, quote, making a modern Britain teaching resource to deal with, and I'm going to quote at length here, negative calls for decolonising the curriculum. Neither the banning of white authors or token expressions of black achievement will help to broaden young minds. We have argued against bringing down statues. Instead, we want all children to reclaim their British heritage. We want to see how Britishness influenced the Commonwealth and local communities, and how the Commonwealth and local communities influenced what we now know as modern Britain. I mean, how nakedly Tory is that? And my favourite two parts of that paragraph. Quote again. One great example would be a dictionary or lexicon of well-known British words which are Indian in origin. Now, that's a joke that was originally invented 20 years ago by the BBC Indian sketch show programme, Goodness Gracious Me. But they've just stolen that from that. And then my favourite bit in that paragraph. There is a new story about the Caribbean experience, which speaks to the slave period, and not only being about profit and suffering, but how culturally African people transformed themselves into a remodeled African Britain. So in other words, bring back slavery. It was a good thing. So I would like to propose that the making of modern Britain teaching resource includes the following books. One, The Non-Institutional Racist's Guide to Preserving Statues. Two, The Non-Institutional Racist's Guide to the Upside of Slavery. Three, The Non-Institutional Racist's Guide to Surgically Removing Your Own Colon. And of course, finally, The Non-Institutional Racist Thug Dictionary of English Words with Indian Origins. If you didn't get that last joke, it might help you to know that the word thug is actually an Indian word, as opposed to racist thug, which is an entirely British invention. So maybe I am being a little harsh here. Perhaps institutional racism is a bit less of an issue than it was yesterday. Rest in peace, Your Royal Highness. My name has been Haroon Mashad. Thank you very much for having me on. I'm going to hand you back to your host, Steve Henn. Cheers.
Yes. Hey, excellent. Oh, am I coming back to myself? That's no, great. Hey, yeah, I know, but I can hear me coming back as well. But that's oh no, I've gone. That's good. Maybe it was. So thank you so much, Haroon. How's your evening going?
Yeah, good. I'm the one who was having dinner with his wife, which Steve interfered with by asking me to come onto this, but I'm very happy to do that. Not that there was any problem with the dinner I was having. That was very nice.
So many ways that could have gone there.
Well,
and I'm glad it was just virtually that I interfered.
So, yeah, thank you for having me on. And, sorry about the circumstances we're all in today. I know we're all feeling a tinge of sadness that the world is just a slightly less white place.
Yeah, I think that's good. Did you say that where you worked?
I did not this time, no. I'm very happy to tell you. You do know where I work. For those of you who don't know me, and I quite often do mention this in my comedy, I actually work in the House of Commons during the day. I'm a human resource manager in the House of Commons. But there is a problem with me doing stuff about the House of Commons, of course, because I wrote a bit, the staff handbook, that says I could be dismissed for gross misconduct if I do or say anything that Parliament distributed. Didn't really think that through when I wrote that bit in the staff handbook. So there you go.
But didn't Petty Patel get found out and no one did anything anyway? Is that
yes.
rules for one and rules for other?
Yeah, I mean, it's a different it's a different set of rules, but I would certainly be points I would be making in my defence if my employer did try to discipline bringing Parliament into disrepute. I would also be bringing into the fact that, unlike some, I haven't taken the second world's best public health authority and still managed to preside over more deaths per head of population than virtually any other nation on earth. So, there's bringing Parliament into disrepute and there's Boris Johnson.
Yeah, don't break my heart. Don't. Boris.
No British Conservative government could or should sign up to any such arrangement.
Yeah, indeed.
Hey, right, that's the politics over with. Thank you so much, Haroon. Come back again anytime if I've got space. I hope you'll be able to do more live stuff, though, as things open up. So,
wonderful. Thank you. Look forward to any of those. Yes, cheers. Thank you very much for having
cheers.
Me.
Cheers. Thank you very much, Haroon Mashad. Thank you. Wow. Hey, do you know what, people? Last week, we tried and we tried and we tried and we tried and we tried to get this person on. But we have him here now in the studio. You are so lucky to have Wade.
Use your personal details and your account to place that order.
Nope, it's
and
just...
you will going to be charged for that product.
Nope, that's not me.
So just let me know that. Do you want to continue with that order or you simply want to cancel it?
So this is Wade, ladies and gentlemen.
No, that's not me. I never made the order, ma'am. So take me off, do what you need to do, but I never made that one.
Okay, so maybe we'll get Wade back next week. Thank you so much, everybody, for watching the Head House tonight. We had lots of people, and I'm going to tell you who they are in order, because honestly, I have them written down over there. So we had Jimmy Longmuir, Joe Christensen, Av Singh, BC Tree, Haroon Mashad, and Steve Henn. Have a lovely week, and God bless England!
Fuck you, goodbye, you hurt me for the last time. It's time for me to move on, so fuck you and goodbye. I gave you love and I hate it, yeah, all of the time that I wasted. Fuck you, goodbye, you hurt me for the last time.
Wade! Wade! Wade!
$900 purchase in.
Wade!
Unless you want the FBI involved. Do you want the FBI involved?
Wade! 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 Okay. Never mind. We didn't get Wade this time. Maybe we'll get Wade next week. Cheerio!